Food security in Pennsylvania could be impacted by a prolonged government shutdown. And a senior advisor to Governor Josh Shapiro, who resigned, has been accused of sexual assault. Welcome to The Morning Agenda, WITF's daily news podcast, where the only agenda is you. A good morning to you. It's Friday, September 29th. Happy Friday, by the way. This is being recorded at 9:34 a.m. I'm your host, Tim Lambert, as we take this daily trip around the region's top stories. So let's get started in Pittsburgh. If the federal government shuts down, it pauses funding for a raft of services that support vulnerable and low-income Americans. Sarah Bowden from our partner WESA reports it includes the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program.
SNAP is funded by the federal government and administered at the state level. It helps low-income people afford groceries, reducing food insecurity. Pennsylvania's Department of Human Services says if there's a federal shutdown, funding for SNAP will be there through October, but things are less certain in November unless Congress fixes its budget impasse. State DHS Secretary Dr. Val Arkush.
SNAP in particular is a bit challenging because it is entirely federally funded. And so to replace that with state dollars in a very short time frame would indeed be quite challenging.
Nearly 2 million Pennsylvanians are enrolled in SNAP, and almost 1 in 3 recipients are children. A key figure in Governor Josh Shapiro's administration is resigning. My colleague Ben Wasserstein reports documents show Secretary of Legislative Affairs Mike Vereb has been accused of sexually harassing a staffer.
In documents filed in May with the State Human Relations Commission and obtained by WITF, a woman who worked in the Office of Legislative Affairs alleges repeated sexual harassment by Mike Vereb. Her complaint states she was subjected to offensive and sexually inappropriate comments in the workplace. She reported that other employees asked if she was being harassed by him. Shapiro, a Democrat, chose Vereb, a Republican, to be his Secretary of Legislative Affairs in January 2023. In that role, Vereb served as a liaison between the governor's office and the legislature. Before that, he had worked for Shapiro in the office of the Attorney General.
Shapiro's office said in a news release that Vereb will be replaced by senior advisor to the governor, T.J. Yablonsky. The announcement of Vereb's resignation includes no reason for his departure. A Lehigh County man has been sentenced to prison for his role in the January 6th assault on the U.S. Capitol. Sarit Lashinsky from our partner WDIY in Allentown has the details.
Craig Michael Bingert, a 32-year-old from Allentown, was sentenced to 96 months in prison, along with 36 months of supervised release on 7 charges, all felonies. Bingert, Sturgeon, and others grabbed a metal bike rack and pushed it against the police line, injuring at least one officer. The two men remained on the Upper West Terrace for at least 2 hours after the assault and stayed on restricted grounds until forcibly removed by police.
As with all January 6th cases, we note at least 92 Pennsylvanians have been charged for their involvement in the Capitol attack to try to keep former President Donald Trump in power, even though he lost the 2020 election. That number is tied with Texas for second most in the country, behind only Florida. Well, Democrats in Congress want to require that gun owners lock up their firearms. Sammy Kaola from our partner WHYY in Philadelphia reports the proposal would impose penalties for leaving guns accessible to minors.
A group of Democratic lawmakers recently filed a discharge petition for House Resolution 660. It aims to force a vote on the House floor. Representative Dwight Evans, who represents parts of West Philadelphia and Center City, recently signed the petition. He noted on Twitter that established safe storage laws could have potentially hindered Chester County prison escapee Danilo Cavalcante from obtaining a firearm from a home during his evasion.
The intent is to limit the access children have to unsecured firearms. Now, Democrats at the state capitol are currently working to pass a comparable safe storage law at the state level. The state police have seen a surge of applicants from people hoping to become troopers in the month since Democratic Governor Josh Shapiro removed college credit requirements. Nearly half of the aspiring cadets were previously ineligible. The agency says in the past month, a little more than 1,200 applicants applied, 524 of whom hold a high school diploma or equivalent. In the last hiring cycle, some 1,700 applications were submitted over the course of 6 months. Shapiro's change removed the educational requirement that applicants had to have 60 college credits, which had been in place since the 1990s. Well, the Morning Agenda is available anywhere you find your favorite podcast and on YouTube on the WYTF channel. And you can find us any day of the week, any place you find all that fun stuff. And if you like what you hear, please share it with your friends and on your social media channels. You can play a big part in spreading the word about the Morning Agenda. So on this Friday, I went through about a dozen news sites across central Pennsylvania looking for a few stories to put on your radar because they cover issues that may impact you or your community in the future. So here's what you need to know. A mid-state city is moving to disband its mounted horse patrol and close a fire station. Our sister newsroom, LNP, Lancaster Online, reports Lancaster is making the changes to put more officers on patrol and save money. Public safety represents 60% of the city's budget. Lancaster will close the fire department station 6 in its southwest section at the end of the year and sell the building. The station currently doesn't meet minimum standards for firefighter safety, and bringing it up to current standards would likely cost more than $6.3 million. The 3 full-time mounted police officers and 1 part-time officer will be reassigned to the patrol division. The department's 3 horses will also be sold. The nonprofit supports the department through fundraising for equipment and education outreach. And a York company has been awarded a Defense Department contract. The York Daily Record reports BAE Systems Land and Armaments LP will produce Bradley M2A4 and M7A4 vehicles by the end of January 2026 for $288 million. The M2A4 is designed to carry and support dismounted troops in combat. The M7A4 carries sensor and sighting systems designed to relay targeting information to support artillery fire. And now for a bit of a deeper dive into an issue that covers injection wells. The Federal Environmental Protection Agency has approved an injection well for the disposal of fracking waste in the Pittsburgh suburb of Plum, despite objections from some in the community. Reed Frazier from our partner, the Allegheny Front, reports it would be the second of its kind in the borough.
Westmoreland County-based Penico Environmental Solutions already operates one injection well in Plum, the Sadat 3A. An old well that no longer produces gas. It asked the U.S. EPA to allow it to build another injection well, also using an old gas well. Neighbors objected. Among them was Katie Sheehan. She lives across the street from her parents' house, which is just downhill from the injection site. Her parents began having problems with their spring water around the time the Sadat 3A injection well experienced mechanical problems in 2021.
My parents have lived there 40-some years. Never had an issue with their natural spring until the first injection well went in. So the second one will just be diagonal from their property.
But EPA found the injection well never released any fluids during the incident, and the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection found the groundwater problems experienced by Sheehan's family to be unrelated to the injection well. Sheehan's parents have put in an expensive water filtration system and are trucking in drinking water.
We're having water delivered because we're afraid that our water will be contaminated at the well source here.
She also worries about what increased truck traffic and activity at a second well will mean for their long-term health. The current well averages around 20 to 30 truckloads of wastewater a day. Sheehan has gone to several meetings to protest the new permit.
I feel like it went to deaf ears. It didn't matter. Every effort we've taken to stop the first one, the second one, has gotten us nowhere.
The EPA says it sent an inspector to the Sadat 3A well this summer, where it passed a mechanical integrity test. The wastewater is produced during fracking and contains salts, chemicals, metals, and radioactive materials. Penico's Ben Davis says the fracking industry in Pennsylvania produces millions of barrels of this waste every year.
The wells are of such enormous proportion, and the volume of fluid being used to fracture them is so enormous that there has to be a location or a place to properly dispose of the fluids that can't be recycled.
Davis says the injection well, about 1,800 feet underground, is in a geologic formation that can store ample amounts of oil and gas waste. He says it's bounded on the top and bottom by dense shale layers that should keep the liquid in place.
By putting this fluid in injection wells, we're actually keeping it out of the surface waters and protecting our streams and waterways.
Jillian Graber is with Protect PT, a local environmental group. She's concerned there will be proliferation of injection wells in the region. There are currently 19 permitted wells in Pennsylvania, according to the EPA.
I mean, we've seen what has happened in Ohio with methane migration and with migration of fluids from one injection well to conventional wells that are nearby. We know that this stuff moves.
Ohio has over 200 injection wells and accepts millions of gallons of Pennsylvania's fracking waste every year. This month, Ohio regulators suspended injections into four wells after finding they presented an imminent danger because injected fluids had migrated into nearby oil and gas wells.
This is just really, really concerning for the future of an area that has seen the brunt of contamination of extractive industries for years.
The EPA says the wells are required to be monitored to ensure injected fluids don't migrate near drinking water sources. The new EPA permit isn't the end of the story with this injection well. Plum Borough and Protect PT have sued to block the well in state court. A hearing in that lawsuit is set for October 10th. I'm Reed Frazier.
And lo and behold, it's time to wrap up today's episode of The Morning Agenda. So what is the one song you are thinking about today? Let me know all about it. Reach out to me on Twitter. I'm at TLambert895. And you can check out our Spotify playlist, The Morning Agenda Song of the Day, September 2023. And you'll find today's song, the final song of this playlist for the month. It's off Pearl Jam's Yield album, Wishlist. That does it for The Morning Agenda. It's a daily news podcast from WITF where the only agenda is you. And one programming note, I will be out of the office from Monday through Wednesday the 11th, taking a bit of a break after finishing that big project about my dad's experience in an atomic test in 1953. If you haven't had a chance to listen to it, check out yesterday's episode. I'm your host, Tim Lambert. Thank you so much for listening today. Your company is always appreciated. Be well, enjoy the weekend, and we'll talk again when I get back in the office on October 12th.